Subcommittee on Government Operations and the Subcommittee on Healthcare Benefits and Administrative Rules will come to order, and without objection, the Chair is authorized to declare a recess at any time. Good afternoon. Thank you all for being here. And as we call this to order, in recent years, an alarming trend has emerged. And as we see the executive branch collecting various monies for fees, fines, penalties, and settlements, the use of this money without providing Congress a clear accounting of how much money is being collected and what it's being spent on. As we see, for example, according to the President's fiscal year 2017 budget proposal, $231.8 billion in user fee charges go directly to an agency which subsequently spends the fund without congressional action, and an additional $302.2 billion in user fees will be spent according to the legislation that established the charge. These are enormous sums of money that have the possibility of being spent without any true congressional oversight. This week, Chairman Chaffetz released a report which looked at the issue of government-collected fines and penalties. Similar to the user fees, fines and penalties are not an insignificant sum of money. The 34 agencies surveyed reported that over $83 billion being collected between 2010 and 2015. More startling than the sum of money collected was the complete lack of transparency, a failure of uniform accounting systems, and a slow agency response time. Some heavy hitters, such as the Department of Treasury, were unable to provide the committee with a complete response regarding its various bureaus and offices, which is completely unacceptable. I still have no idea how much the Internal Revenue Service collected with its fines and penalty authority, which we all know would be significant. Something that is deeply troubling is that given the massive discretion that the IRS has to level the penalties against American taxpayers, this sum could be enormous. Without a complete picture of the funds flowing into the government, Congress is limited in their ability to appropriate funds accurately and prevent waste, fraud, and abuse and mismanagement. The power of the purse is one of the most important responsibilities bestowed upon Congress in the Constitution, and we must ensure that this power is not obstructed by federal agencies. Now, while I recognize that Congress has allowed certain agencies to utilize collected funds to operate, rather than go through the appropriations process under President Obama, this has taken on a more meaningful role as the executive branch has utilized these collected funds or settlements to the funds administrative as priorities. So, in my opinion, this executive branch discretion has gone too far. We have lost the transparency needed to understand what is being collected and allocated. And in light of these concerns, today's hearing is meant to examine the use of the fees, the fines, the penalties, and settlements by federal agencies to engage in activities that have not been specifically appropriated or authorized by Congress. We want to hear from our panel of witnesses about the appropriate legislative solutions to this concern, and specifically hear feedback on the legislative options such as H.R. 5499, the Agency Accountability Act of 2016, which was proposed by my colleague, the gentleman from Alabama, Mr. Palmer. This is an important topic that we need to know what the federal government is truly spending and what they are collecting in order to reduce the deficit and get the Americans' fiscal house in order. I want to thank our panel of witnesses for being here today, and I will recognize the gentleman from Virginia, my good friend, the ranking member of the Subcommittee on Government Operations, Mr. Connolly, for his opening statement.
I thank my good friend from North Carolina, and I welcome our witnesses today. Today's hearing will examine one of Congress's most important constitutional powers. Article 1, Section 9 of the Constitution grants Congress the power of the purse, sole authority over the direction of public funds. The American people entrust Congress to wield that power in their best interest. Over the course of history, Congress has at times appropriately delegated these powers to certain government agencies. It has not done so carelessly or without parameters. When Congress has authorized agencies to collect fees, fines, penalties, or settlements, it has also placed limitations on those agencies and exercised oversight over their use of collected funds. Agency collection of fees is not a new concept. It was not invented by Barack Obama. The example of customs comes to mind as one such authority that has existed since the beginning of the Republic. Agencies have retained import duty collections since the first United States Congress in 1789. The practice of agency retention of collections continued into the 20th century with land grazing fees, an authority which has remained with the Bureau of Land Management for range improvement programs since the early 1900s when Teddy Roosevelt was in the presidency. Today, similar dedicated collections of funds available without further congressional action can be found in programs supporting the Department of Justice's Crime Victims Fund, the National Park Service fees, the Environmental Protection Agency's Superfund settlements, the Tennessee Valley Authority collections, the Federal Protective Service fees, and the Federal Aviation Administration Franchise Fund customer fees, to name but a few. In all cases, Congress allows agencies to retain collections and self-sustain certain programs in order to make government more efficient. Today's proposed legislative solution, H.R. 5499, the Agency Accountability Act, which has been referred to this committee, in my opinion, is the antithesis of efficiency. From my reading of the bill, it seems that it would require every single collection currently retained at agencies instead to be deposited into the general fund and obligated by the Committee of Appropriations. Every victim compensation award and every whistleblower reward would require the Committee on Appropriations to act. How many times in recent history has Congress failed to pass appropriations bills and instead passed an omnibus appropriation bill or a continuing resolution because Congress could not reach an agreement on critical government funding? We're about to do it again within the next week. H.R. 5499 will have unintended consequences, many of which would be detrimental to the very good government mechanisms we are committed to in this committee on a bipartisan basis. One essential good governance mechanism to which this legislation would render serious harm is the protection of whistleblowers, a cause championed by this committee. Much of government fraud detection relies upon whistleblowers. We will hear from an expert today on how whistleblower funds sustained via agency collections are crucial to protecting and incentivizing those willing to shed light on fraud, waste, and abuse in our government, a mission that goes to the very core of this committee's mission. We will hear that whistleblowers are only willing to risk their careers and blow the whistle if there is some protection in the form of an award. That's why Congress authorized agencies to issue those awards to whistleblowers, to guarantee that one of the incentives for whistleblowers to come forward is never in doubt and never tied up in uncertain appropriations processes. The effects of this bill would be to gut the guarantees to whistleblowers and the services they provide. That alone is reason enough to question H.R. 5499. I believe the sponsors of that bill intend to increase transparency. I don't doubt their motivation. That's a laudable goal. But H.R. 5499 is more than that. It's a sweepingly broad and radical proposal that I believe would seriously impair the ability of government to function. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman. The chair welcomes the participation of our colleague, the representative, Mr. Palmer from Alabama. He's actually the sponsor of H.R. 5499, the Agency Accountability Act of 2016, which we look forward to discussing today. I ask unanimous consent that Mr. Palmer be allowed to fully participate in today's hearing. And without objection, so ordered. The chair now recognizes the ranking member of the Subcommittee on Health Care Benefits and Administrative Rules, Mr. Boyle, for his opening statement.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and welcome to our witnesses. Look forward to hearing from you today. As my esteemed colleague, Mr. Connolly, has stated, The ability of agencies to retain collections is not new. Congress has authorized agencies since the nation's very beginning, and it has become a mechanism by which we ensure that the necessary work done by our federal government is financially self-sustained. Congress alone makes the decision to authorize certain programs to retain and spend funds. Congress has made that decision many times, everything from the National Park Service user fees to antitrust settlements at the DOJ, from whistleblower protections of pollution on ships to consumer protection funds at the newly created, or I guess it's not so newly created, CFPB. H.R. 5499, the Agency Accountability Act, was referred to this committee, and the chairman has called this hearing to consider the bill. This bill would put an end to that practice and prevent Congress from authorizing agencies to retain collections of user fees, fines, and settlements in the future. It is a solution in search of a problem. It is also radical. This bill states, and I quote, "Notwithstanding any other provision of law, an agency that receives a fee, fine, penalty, or proceeds from a settlement shall deposit such amount in the general fund of the Treasury." Quote, "notwithstanding any other provision of the law," quote, is as broad and sweeping a term as can be used in the law. In this case, it means notwithstanding the history of our country. H.R. 5499 would damage mechanisms Congress has created to promote good government. As my colleague Mr. Connolly stated, whistleblowers are crucial to government accountability. The bravery of whistleblowers that do the right thing and shine a light on fraud, waste, and abuse helps our government in its important efforts to increase transparency. H.R. 5499 would have the effect of disincentivizing whistleblowers from coming forward with helpful information. Make no mistake about it, this bill is reckless. It will cost taxpayers more money because it will discourage whistleblowers from coming forward to expose fraud. If transparency is a goal of this bill, then I support that goal. But there are better paths forward that would do none of the harm this heavy-handed bill would cause. And with that, Mr. Chairman, and to Ranking Member Connolly, I'm happy to yield the rest of my time.
I thank the gentleman for his remarks. I will hold the record open for 5 legislative days for any member who would like to submit a written statement. We'll now recognize our panel of witnesses. I'm pleased to welcome Ms. Heather Krause, Acting Director of Strategic Issues at the U.S. Government Accountability Office. Welcome. Ms. Krause will be accompanied by Edda Emanuele Perez, Managing Associate General Counsel at the Office of U.S. Accountability Office. Her expertise on this issue will be important for the subject matter of this hearing, so she will be sworn in as well. Mr. Kevin Kosar, Senior Fellow and Governance Project Director at R Street Institute, welcome. Mr. Hudson Hollister, Executive Director of the Data Coalition Act, welcome. It's good to see you again. And Mr. Stephen M. Cohn, Executive Director of the National Whistleblower Center, thank you for your work. Welcome to you all. And pursuant to committee rules, all witnesses will be sworn in before they testify. So if you would please rise and raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? All right, thank you. Please be seated. Let the record reflect that all witnesses answered in the affirmative. In order to allow enough time for discussion, we would appreciate if you would limit your oral testimony to 5 minutes. However, your entire written statement will be made part of the record. Ms. Krause, you are now recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman Meadows and Jordan, Ranking Members Conley and Boyle, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to discuss our work on federal fees, fines, penalties, and settlements. Congress exercises its constitutional power of the purse by appropriating funds and prescribing conditions for their use. As you know, Congress provides agencies with budget authority to make financial obligations for specified purposes. Budget authority may be provided through appropriations acts or through other laws that constitute permanent appropriations. In addition to tax revenues, the federal government receives funds from a variety of sources, including fees, fines, penalties, and settlements. These collections involve billions of dollars annually and fund many programs, including those integral to our nation's security, the security of our financial systems, and the protection of natural resources. The design and structure of the statutory authorities for these collections varies widely. My statement today focuses on four types of statutory authorities that establish how agencies can use their fee, fine, and penalty collections and the varying degrees of agency flexibility and congressional control. These types are, one, collections deposited to the Treasury as miscellaneous receipts, two, collections dedicated to a related program and available subject to further appropriation, three, collections dedicated to a related program and available without further congressional action, and four, collections available based on a combination of these authorities. First, Congress has specified that certain fees, fines, and penalties be deposited to the Treasury as miscellaneous receipts. These funds are not dedicated to the agency or program under which they are collected and are used for general support of federal government activities. For example, $2.7 billion in civil monetary penalties collected from financial institutions for certain enforcement actions were deposited to the Treasury as miscellaneous receipts from 2009 through 2015. Second, Congress has specified that some collections be dedicated to a related program, but cannot be used by an agency without further appropriation. For example, cargo importers pay merchandise processing fees to Customs and Border Protection. These fees are deposited in the Customs User Fee account and are only available to CBP through annual appropriations. Third, Congress has authorized some agencies to collect and use their fees, fines, and penalties without additional congressional action. This is considered permanent funding authority. Agencies with this authority have varying degrees of autonomy, depending on the extent to which the statute limits when, how much, and for what purpose funds may be used. For example, USDA's Animal and Plant Health Inspection Service is authorized to set and collect user fees to cover the cost of agriculture quarantine inspection services. These collections are available without fiscal year limitation and may be used for inspection-related purpose without further appropriation. Even if an agency has a permanent authority to use collections, Congress can still place limitations on the funds in any given year. For example, in recent fiscal years, annual appropriations acts limited the amount of fines and penalties from the Crime Victims Fund that could be used to fund victims assistance programs and other activities. Last, in some cases, Congress has provided agencies with a combination of different authorities. For example, each year, the Drug Enforcement Administration deposits the first $15 million in fees that it collects from drug manufacturers and other registrants to the Treasury as miscellaneous receipts. Fees collected beyond that amount are available to the agency and used to recover the full cost of DEA's diversion control program. These different design options involve different trade-offs on agency flexibility versus congressional control. For example, Congress gains more oversight opportunities when it requires collections to be annually appropriated. Conversely, if Congress grants an agency authority to use collections without further congressional action, the agency may be able to respond more quickly to customers or changing conditions. This concludes my statement. My colleague Etta Emanuele Perez and I would look forward to answering any questions.
Thank you, Ms. Krause. You said her name much better than I did, so I appreciate that. And Mr. Kosar, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Well, I thank the chairman and ranking member and the rest of the committee and its staff for having me here. My name is Kevin Kosar. I'm a senior fellow at R Street Institute, a think tank here in Washington, D.C. And previous to that, I spent 11 years at the Congressional Research Service. In my current position, I co-direct the Legislative Branch Capacity Working Group, a nonpartisan gathering of scholars and congressional experts who aim, as we like to put it, to make Congress great again. We meet each month here on the Hill to discuss aspects of congressional capacity, produce research on it, and we do all this in the hopes that Congress will empower itself to carry out its constitutional duties and to do what the public expects of it. So I'm obviously delighted to be here today. because the power of the purse is a fundamental legislative authority. It's a power that aims to limit executive power, encourage agency accountability to elected officials, and to curb corruption. And it is a power, unfortunately, that Congress has delegated away in many instances. I was asked to testify on the subject of federal agencies and their self-funding activities, and it's a large and obviously complex topic, to say the least. The President's budget reports the government collected $516 billion from the public this past year in the form of fees, user charges, and the like, which is a significant portion of the government's total revenues. Now, the principle that the collection and expenditures of funds should flow through Congress is longstanding. It is in our Constitution. All authority for collecting monies from the public and expending it are explicated in Article 1, which established the legislative branch. One will find no authorities over spending or collecting money in Article 2. Instead, the President is to ensure that the executive branch take care that the law be faithfully executed. The principle of congressional control over spending is also expressed in the Miscellaneous Receipts Act, first enacted in 1849. It obliges executive agents who collect funds from the public to promptly deposit the monies in the Treasury, whereafter Congress may reappropriate the funds or not, and also may direct to what the funds will be appropriated. While the principle is age-old and clear, congressional practice has frequently veered from it. As I note in my written testimony, the very first Congress passed a law that allowed customs officers and collectors in our young nation's ports to pay themselves from the monies they collected on the ships that arrived at the ports. Over the past 200-plus years, Congress repeatedly has enacted exceptions to the principles that all funds should flow into the Treasury, and the rationales have been many and varied. Here are just a few of them. One rationale is that allowing the agency to expend some portion of its fees is logistically more sensible and that it creates incentives for higher productivity. Such was the case with the aforementioned 1789 Customs Act. Customs officials were actually compensated based on the number of ships they inspected, and it was at a rate that was written into the law. In the second instance, Congress' rationale has been that an agency should be self-funding commercial enterprise and should not, its activities should not be borne by the taxpayers as a whole. And therefore, if it's to operate in a financially self-sustaining manner, it needs to have broad discretion over the spending of its receipts and immediate access to their use. We see this with the Postal Service. A third rationale one finds is a political one, and this one is much more complicated in that we often will have a majority in Congress who wants to insulate an agency's spending from congressional influence by the minority, because the minority may disagree with what the agency is going to do with the spending. The Consumer Financial Protection Bureau may well be an example of this line of thinking, wherein it is able to derive revenues through the Federal Reserve, but then it also has this fund through which it can use these monies for very, very broad purposes put in the statute. It is largely insulated, therefore, from appropriations. Now, assuredly, these aren't all the reasons Congress has created exceptions to the principle, but just a few. To anyone but experts in this room and appropriators, the government's practices for collecting funds from the public are bewildering. But I think the basic takeaway is fairly obvious. The progressive delegating away of the power of the purse, by definition, diminishes legislative authority. By how much? I'm not sure, and I think that would be something that would be interesting to discuss. It seems a difficult thing to quantify. It is heartening, therefore, to see Congress discussing this topic and discussing H.R. 5499, and I'm hopeful that fruits of these discussions are that Congress can reclaim some of its powers of the purse. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kosar. Mr. Hollister, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Chairman Meadows, Ranking Member Connolly, Chairman Jordan, Ranking Member Boyle, thank you for inviting me to testify today. In 1802, President Thomas Jefferson wrote to Albert Gallatin, the fourth Secretary of the Treasury, supporting Gallatin's plan to, quote, simplify our system of finance and bring it within the comprehension of every member of Congress. President Jefferson believed that federal spending information had become so complex and so fragmented that only the experts could understand it. But Jefferson had a solution. By expressing federal spending as, quote, one consolidated mass, he wrote, we might hope to see the finances of the Union as clear and intelligible as a merchant's books, so that every member of Congress and every man of any mind in the Union should be able to comprehend them and consequently to control them. 214 years later, we face the same problem and we need the same solution. The federal government is the largest and most complex organization in human history. But by expressing all federal spending information as one consolidated data set, we can use commercially available software to make it, quote, clear and intelligible, so that Congress and the people can comprehend it and control it. Federal spending information is complex and fragmented. Hundreds of agencies separately report their receipts and their account balances to Treasury, their budget information to the White House OMB, and their contracting details to the GSA. But 2 years ago, this committee unanimously approved the Digital Accountability and Transparency Act, or DATA Act, which directs Treasury and OMB to create a single government-wide data structure for all federal spending information. In May 2017, this May, when every agency begins to report standardized spending information using that structure, they will create a single electronic picture of all spending. In a few minutes, I'm going to show you what that picture should look like. I know this committee is particularly interested in non-appropriated receipts, fines, fees, penalties, settlements that agencies receive outside the appropriations process. So far, the DATA Act structure focuses on money going out, expenditures, not on money coming in, receipts. So that single picture, the single electronic picture, won't be able to provide full detail on how fines, fees, penalties, and settlements are spent. However, this information already exists. It is already being reported to Treasury. It is maintained in the Central Accounting Reporting System at Treasury, and it could be reflected in the DATA Act structure. Congress can direct Treasury and OMB to expand the DATA Act to accommodate that information, and in my view, Congress should. When I served as counsel to this committee, I worked on the first version of what became the DATA Act. I resigned from the staff in 2012 in order to start the Data Coalition and help then-Chairman Issa and Ranking Member Cummings get the DATA Act passed. The Data Coalition is a trade association of nearly 40 companies whose commercially available software can inform decisions, illuminate fraud, and automate compliance, but only if we have consolidated and standardized data to work with. Starting in May 2017, if all goes well, commercially available software will use that single data set to portray an electronic picture of federal spending. And I want to ask if we could have slide 7 displayed for just a minute. This will be very familiar to Chairman Meadows, who has demonstrated this himself. The DATA Act should allow us to navigate from the entire government all the way to specific agencies, specific appropriations. This picture you see is interactive. If you click on one of the agencies or you click on one of the items there, you can go down all the way to individual items. You can navigate from the entire HHS to a particular contract. This level of interactivity will be possible across the entire executive branch. Now, the reliability of this picture is going to depend on how well agencies comply with the DATA Act starting in May 2017. They have to report high-quality data. As I mentioned, even after the DATA Act, there will be some limitations. The data structure that Treasury and OMB have created focuses on expenditures, not receipts. That means we won't easily be able to differentiate between appropriated and not appropriated funding sources. It is possible for Congress to amend the DATA Act to direct Treasury and OMB to expand the data structure so that it does include receipts. I asked our Data Coalition members to come up with a prototype visualization that shows what an expanded electronic picture of federal spending might look like, and I would like to ask for slide 14 to be displayed, please. Here we see a navigation that itemizes the federal government's non-appropriated receipts, and it allows us to zoom in on a particular agency, programs within that agency. This information comes from the information Treasury is already collecting and maintaining. But if this information is incorporated into the DATA Act, this means we can see the connection between the receipts and the outlays. We can follow this all the way to the contracts and the expenditures. The Coalition has prepared recommendations for the committee on how to amend the DATA Act to expand the data structure and ensure that receipts and payments are brought into the picture. By tracking all the complexity of federal spending using a single government-wide data structure and by publishing all that information as one data set, we can realize President Jefferson's vision of, quote, one consolidated mass, quote, clear and intelligible. This committee began that work by passing the DATA Act, by holding the executive branch accountable to follow the law, and by expanding that law where necessary, the committee can finish it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hollister, and thank you for illuminating what we may be able to do in terms of giving greater transparency. We look forward to seeing the progress as we, I know the ranking member and I have been very in tune in a bipartisan way of following your work. Mr. Kahn, you are now recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairman, ranking members, members of the committee.
Yeah, if you can pull that a little closer to you, yeah.
And thank you, Chairman, ranking members, members of the committee, for this opportunity to share with you the benefit of my 32 years of representing whistleblowers and how H.R. 5499 may impact on those cases. This committee has a long and distinguished bipartisan record of supporting whistleblowers, and I am confident that you will ensure that nothing will inadvertently harm the existing statutory structure that works extremely well, is transparent, and saves the taxpayers billions of dollars. To understand how this process works, we need to look at the current laws and why whistleblowing is so effective. The Founding Fathers were true visionaries. They understood the importance of using citizens as a bulwark for ensuring accountability. On July 30, 1778, the Continental Congress passed perhaps the world's first whistleblower law, encouraging every American and declaring it their duty to report crimes and misdemeanors to appropriate authorities. The very first Congress, starting in 1789, passed 18 whistleblower reward laws. They didn't call them whistleblowers then, they called them informants. 18. And that structure of those laws has been passed on, and the modern whistleblower laws that are most effective are modeled on what the Founding Fathers did. And let's see why it works. Slide one, or my chart one in my testimony, shows how fraud is actually detected in real life. As in my testimony, these are statistically verifiable numbers, and you'll see to the far right, the tip, or the whistleblower, is the number one source of all fraud. Without a program to encourage fraud detection by tipsters or whistleblowers, crime will pay. Slide two, which is, again, statistically verifiable, shows the real life of what happens at the job. And it shows that only 2% of the witnesses to fraud and misconduct actually report that fraud outside their agency. 2%. And that's to anyone, not going to the proper law enforcement authority. If you want to have an effective accountability system, you need to figure out how to make that 2% real and effective. And guess what? The model used by the Founding Fathers works. And if we can go to slide, the next slide, which is chart five in my testimony. When Chuck Grassley passed the False Claims Act in 1986, and reinstated these models used by the Founding Fathers, which permits a reward to the whistleblower paid immediately from the collected proceeds, not through an appropriations process. They get the reward based on the fruits of their original information, the sacrifice they go through, the risks they take. Look what happened. These are the Department of Justice figures to the penny. The ability to detect fraud skyrocketed. The ability to hold fraudsters accountable skyrocketed. Look how it went from a handful of millions before you activated the whistleblower to billions and billions every year. The final chart shows that, the next slide shows that today 70% of all fraud detection coming in is coming from the whistleblower. The legislation being proposed does not take the reality of whistleblowing into consideration, but I know this committee will act and make sure it is protected. I also want to state that there is an appropriate oversight for these funds, and whistleblowers are dependent upon them, and I look forward to working with the committee to have better oversight. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kahn. I can assure you that whistleblowers are a vital part of what we do from an oversight standpoint. There is not a month that goes by that I don't get a call on my private cell phone from some whistleblower somewhere suggesting that we look at something. And so with that, let me make sure I understand. So if we were to exempt out the whistleblower provision in this and make sure that it's not included in Mr. Palmer's piece of legislation, you wouldn't have an issue with this legislation. Is that correct?
Well, I'm only really an expert on the whistleblower part.
So if we exempted it, you wouldn't have an issue. Is that correct?
Exactly. As National Whistleblower Center, that's our concern.
Well, I think we look forward to hearing from others on that, but I believe that a friendly amendment that would protect our whistleblowers would be in order. And I know I've talked to the gentleman from Alabama about that very subject, and he seems very willing to accommodate. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Michigan, the vice chair of the Subcommittee on Government Operations, Mr. Wahlberg.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the panel for being here today. In my other life, other committee work, chairing the Subcommittee on Workforce Protections, we look at regulatory issues and the high cost of regulations that go on. So this discussion today focuses very clearly on additional costs resulting from regulation. Mr. Kosar, last year, I believe it was, you authored an article on increasing federal regulations and how Congress should reassert their authority in the regulatory process. I recently introduced a series of regulatory reform measures which focus specifically on harmful labor regulations. When you see the costs last year approaching almost $2 trillion of regulatory cost to business alone, that's it, not including collections and everything that goes on, it's an important thing to consider. One of the measures that I introduced, H.R. 6325, the Workforce Regulatory Review Act, creates an independent regulatory review commission tasked with removing a third of all the regulatory obligations created by Department of Labor alone. So let me ask you, Mr. Kosar, do you have any thoughts on proposals to establish commissions tasked with reviewing and eliminate regulations?
Thank you for the question. I have not reviewed your piece of legislation, regrettably, but I will say as a general proposition, yeah, I favor commissions to take a look at these things. I mean, when you consider the size of the corpus of regulations, no human being could fully appreciate or understand what's in there. And it just seems self-evident that there is some value in having a group dedicated to looking at it and going through and saying, this is anachronistic, or guess what, this regulation didn't actually work out and we should consider getting rid of it.
Any other ideas beyond a commission like that that you might have that could more effectively monitor the output of new regulations and the costs that are inherent in those regulations?
Well, I think two leading proposals, the ones that have certainly gotten a lot of discussion, are some mechanism similar to a RAINS Act, wherein, you know, you would look at a whole ball of these things, mm-hmm. and figure out which ones are problematic or undesirable for whatever reason, and then have a fast-track type authority to run them through. That's a commission version, or the RAINS Act, which has the tripwire where a regulation of a certain size with a certain quantity of cost cannot actually take effect until Congress affirmatively acts upon it. So that would be another way to go. And then regulatory budgeting.
Yeah, certainly familiar with that and supportive of it. Your written testimony mentions that the complexities for collection of fees and settlements have increased as government has grown. Could you elaborate further on this point?
That line is self-evident, but is one of those things that came out as I had this past week stuck my nose back in the President's FY 2017 budget. It's unbelievably complex. And there's a basic principal-agent relationship between legislative branch and executive branch. As the persons who authorize the taking of money from the public, the legislators want to keep an eye to make sure that the money is being well spent. When that amount grows to a $4 trillion or some such number, it's really hard to keep track of all those dollars, especially if you're not doing the appropriating.
So your method of simplifying the complexities of collecting fees and settlements specifically is what? review that for us?
The first thing that I find vexing is the separation, the kind of conceptual separation that's been around since at least 1967 between government receipts and then the offsetting receipts and collections. And how is an offsetting collection different from an offsetting receipt? And in fact, Congress has often written into statute exceptions to these rules. So something that should be a receipt is instead a collection or something like that. Maybe in an effort to be too precise, we got too complex. If you have smart people in this town who are looking at the federal budget and having a hard time understanding it, I don't quite know how the rest of the country can understand it. So I know some folks who are working at a Brookings budget group, and one of the ideas that's being frequently brought up is we need to simplify budget concepts. We need to rethink because we're relying on stuff that was ginned up a long time ago.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
I thank the gentleman. The chair recognizes Mr. Connolly for his question.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Kosar, I want to make sure I understood your testimony. Is it your testimony that Congress has been too whimsical or careless over the years in devolving these powers to agencies and ought to re-arrogate them back to itself through the appropriations process?
I would suggest that the various incidents where the authority has been delegated away should be reviewed. Do the rationales that originally propelled the delegation still make sense, or have they become anachronistic, or has it just not worked out?
Fair enough. It is not your contention, however, that you or R Street Institute have looked at in depth the other impacts, the negative impacts on agencies that currently engage in that practice legally through the delegation of authority by the Congress. For example, you haven't looked at the potential impact of doing that in the Department of Justice's Crime Victims Fund.
Oh, no. We have not done an assessment, and we certainly haven't looked at each program and
tried to. Or what it might do to the Superfund cleanup process.
Correct.
Or Tennessee Valley Authority collections and what it uses those for.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
You're right.
And likewise, the Federal Protective Service program through the use of its fees.
Correct.
Or the Federal Aviation Administration Franchise Fund customer fees.
No, sir, we haven't looked into
those. Okay. Just want to make sure that it's one thing to say, you got to look at it, maybe some of these authorities are too broad, but that's not the same as testifying, I've looked in depth at the impact and it's negligible, or it's tolerable. We don't know sitting here. So we can, not that you are, because you've just clarified your testimony, but one needs to be careful in terms of impacts. And my view is, before we do any of this, we have to understand what the impacts would be, because over 200 years of history, this has a lot of entanglements and commitments, and the disruption could be profound to the operations of government, which is my contention. That doesn't mean don't do some of it. It might not even mean don't do all of it, but we got to know a lot more than we know right now. Ms. Krause, I want to make sure I understand what you're testifying to. GAO looked at this. Why?
This is really based on, we have a body of work that's looked at fees, fines, and penalties, often individual ones, but we also have a body of fee work that's looked at design principles to consider when you're establishing fees. It also applies to fines and penalties. So things to consider in structuring these, especially related to congressional control. As I mentioned in my oral statement, one of those decisions is related to what triggers the use, the congressional trigger of use of funds. So whether it requires further appropriation after it's been collected or whether an agency is allowed to use it through.
But it's not your testimony this practice should end.
We don't take a position.
No. And nor do you contend in this study, like my questioning of Mr. Kosar, that you've looked in depth at the potential impacts of curtailing or conditioning or revoking these authorities that we've delegated?
No, we have not.
Thank you. And Mr. Cohn, your testimony is that if we had a carve out for whistleblowers, you'd be fine.
I don't have a position on the entire bill,
right,
but it absolutely needs a carve out for whistleblowers.
Right. But yeah. I'm bigger than whistleblowers, though I share your concern, as you heard in my opening statement. I think that's an unintended consequence, but my concern is there could be lots of other unintended consequences, and we haven't looked at them. So to act with haste on a bill that I think is well-intentioned and that makes a good point about the kind of willy-nilly delegation of authority that has crept up over the years, that is worthy of examination, and I share my friend from Alabama's commitment to doing that. I think that this bill raises a very important subject we ought to re-examine. But revoking those authorities or putting them on ice, whether it's whistleblower or any of the other fees I listed, there are plenty of others we could talk about, I think could be very disruptive. And I just want to be clear, you're not saying, give me a carve-out and you've got my acquiescence and all the rest. You're only addressing your own issue, which is whistleblowers. And your testimony is limited to the fact that this would have an unintended but devastating impact on whistleblowers and contravene the intent of the Whistleblower Protection Act. That's your testimony, is that correct?
Yes, that is correct.
I thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
The Chair recognizes the Chairman of the full Committee on Health Care and Administrative Rules, Mr. Jordan, the gentleman from Ohio, for a series of questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for having this hearing, and Mr. Palmer, thank you for bringing a good piece of legislation forward. Thank you to our witnesses, and Mr. Cohn, I agree with you. There's nothing wrong with an amendment that would carve out the whistleblowers, much like Mr. Palmer's legislation already exempts the Patent Office and the Postal Service. But I want to try to get a handle on the overall picture here. So as I understand it, there are three major categories. There's fees, there's fines and penalties, and then there's settlements. Money that the people's representatives don't get a direct say on what happens with that money when it comes to the federal government. So, Director Krause, what is the total number, let's just go in that order, fees. What is the amount of fees collected in fiscal year 2017 by the federal government and all the various agencies?
Unfortunately, that number is unknown. The when we've looked at issues particularly related to fees, government-wide sources don't necessarily track back to the specific legal authorities related to the
collection. Here's what the President said. The White House said it was $534 billion. Are you familiar with that number?
I am not familiar with that number.
This is from their budget. For 2017, the table shows that total offsetting collections and offsetting receipts from public are estimated to be $534 billion. Do you accept that number?
I would have to take a look at it closer to understand it.
Is the White House right or wrong?
Unfortunately, I don't.
Is it in the ballpark?
Like I said, we have work ongoing.
For the sake of argument, let's accept what the White House said. It's their budget. They're the head of the executive branch. They're saying it's $500. That's a lot of money. Mm-hmm. You know how much we spend in discretionary spending each year? Or last year? You know how much we spent in discretionary last year?
I don't know that number.
$1.2 trillion. So we have a number that's collected in just fees, just one-third of the three areas. That's almost half of what we spend annually in discretionary spending. That's a pretty big number. It's that $534 billion is approaching what we spend on national defense each year. And again, the people's representatives in the United States Congress don't have a direct say on how that money is spent once it's collected, right? Let's move on to fines and penalties. Do you know how much we collect annually in fines and penalties?
I do not know that based on the data sources that are available.
Yeah, that's stuff we need to know. But the study the committee did over a five-year period determined that number was $83 billion over a five-year period. So again, we're talking billions of dollars. Now, what's interesting, what the committee found out is Treasury couldn't give us any numbers. Specifically, Treasury and the IRS couldn't give us the numbers. This is the IRS. They collect a few fines and penalties. My guess is some amount. So then you have this $83 billion figure that excludes the Internal Revenue Service and any numbers coming from Treasury. And then finally you have the third category, settlements, which now we know settlements is a nice way of saying for some people, particularly when you think about the Justice Department, settlements is another word for a shakedown. Certain companies have reached a settlement with the Justice Department, and then they tell this particular company, it's not just about penalizing you or compensating the real victims. We want you to give money to some nonprofit that we deem as appropriate, and we're going to call it a donation. Interesting use of the word donation. So when you add all these together, could you even hazard a guess how much money in fees, fines and penalties, and settlements the federal government collects in one year?
As I had mentioned, when we've looked at this, there isn't a government-wide source that would allow us to give a reliable total on the amount.
So who can give us that number? I mean, this is what Mr. Palmer's legislation gets to the heart of. We can't even get someone in the federal government to tell us what that total number. We know fees, based on what the White House told us, is roughly equivalent to what we spend on national defense each year. It's roughly equivalent to half of all discretionary spending we did in 2017. We know it's a big number just in the fees category alone. But we'd like to know what it is, fees, fines and penalties, and settlements, what that number totals up to. So who can give us that number?
That is something we have ongoing work looking at, what we call backdoor spending authority, and it is to do an inventory of the accounts that are out there, the budget accounts that are out there for funding that supports outside of the.
Does anyone else in the panel know who? I mean, I would think Office of Management and Budget should be able to give us that number. I would think someone at the Treasury Department, the department in charge of the nation's money and how we, I would think someone there could give us that number. Why can't we get that number in an important hearing on an important piece of legislation that Mr. Palmer has brought forward?
Yes, Mr.
Hollister,
Jordan,
looks like you want to offer an
answer. I sure do. Mr. Jordan, my understanding is that the Treasury Department's Fiscal Service has that information. It's maintained by the Central Accounting Repository Service, and that on the other hand, there are.
Well, Mr. Hollister, why won't they give that information to this nice lady over here, Director Krause, so that she could come here today and give it to Mr. Meadows and this committee?
If I understand right, there are some organizational problems that exist between Treasury's and Ledge Affairs Office and their Fiscal Service.
What does that mean?
That means that sometimes the Fiscal Service and the Ledge Affairs Office don't get along.
Does that mean they're just not going to, well, you know, Mr. Meadows is a nice guy, but we're not going to give him the information? Is that what they're saying?
Well, what it does mean is that the information that's in the President's budget that you cited and the information that's in the monthly Treasury statement that comes out every month that has at least a line item for miscellaneous receipts, that's coming from somewhere. It's coming from the system that Treasury maintains.
Yeah. Well, we'd like that information so that we can actually get moving on Mr. Palmer's legislation with the appropriate amendments like Mr. Cohn has offered. But this is exactly why the gentleman from Alabama is on the right track with an important piece of legislation. With that, I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman. The chair recognizes Mr. Bowl for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I wanted to narrow in specifically on this whistleblower portion of it, because beyond just the two pieces of legislation that we're talking about today, I think it's actually important for reasons far beyond that and for all the members who are here to better understand this. Because I was interested in reading all of your testimony and particularly the charts. The exponential growth has been staggering in the amount of money collected. We're talking about from the early 1990s, roughly 1991 till today. So over 25 years, by my back of the envelope math, a 9 times increase in the amount of revenue. I'm curious what specific rewards or programs within the umbrella of the whistleblowing would you say has been most effective in cutting out waste, fraud, and abuse, and, of course, generating revenue?
Thank you. And that growth is triggered by empowering the insiders who are critical for fraud. Fraud is designed to be hidden.
Right.
You need the insider. The False Claims Act is really the model because it's been around for 30 years, and you can test it. And the Department of Justice, unlike apparently in other programs, to the penny figures out how much the whistleblowers are bringing in and how much the government is finding on its own. Because they have to, if the whistleblower brings it in, they have to give the reward.
Right.
So these numbers are literally to the cent.
Yeah.
And it's just incredible, the growth. Other programs that are more modern, they don't have the track record, but the SEC is reporting incredible findings. The chair is talking about blueprints and unbelievably high quality information. Why? Think about it. If your reward is based on the truthfulness of your information, the accuracy of your information, and the quality of your information, you're going to be weeding out. You're going to get the best sources. It's going to help the government. It's going to get the big fish. SEC is seeing that, although they're still relatively new. In offshore illegal accounts, illegal Swiss banking, one whistleblower, Bradley Birkenfeld, literally broke the bank. $780 million fine to UBS. They had 18,000 5,000 illegal U.S. accounts. And that triggered a voluntary program of 50,000 Americans, millionaires and billionaires, coming back and paying fines. I told it up to about $13 billion, triggered by a whistleblower because the people didn't want to get caught. If you empower the insider, the positive results are truly remarkable.
Another way of thinking about this is essentially we've created a market for this, for the insider now can bring this information forward, and there's essentially a market for this sort of information that previously did not exist at all. You wanted to add to that?
Absolutely true. The University of Chicago Booth School of Economics, you know, these are no liberals. You know, these guys looked at it and concluded that without rewards,
right,
there's no incentive. In fact, they couldn't even understand why anyone would blow the whistle. But with those rewards, and they studied every major fraud case in a period of time, it was an incredible study. They said they work remarkably well, they're not frivolous, and they recommended expanding the use of that process. You're talking about, to just put it bluntly, the goose that lays the golden egg. And I'm just saying, don't kill it.
So let's take the next step then. If it were killed, either purposely or inadvertently through this or any other legislation, what specifically would be the ramification?
I will tell you, I will have a $500 hammer I can sell you. It's as simple as that. When you look at the state of federal procurement before Senator Grassley fixed it, if you look at that state, it was so bad. Yet I have the opportunity to talk to people within business, and they tell me the impact, far from just the recoveries, the increase in compliance programs, the fear of detection, making people do the right thing. And guess what? Making honesty pay, making the markets more fair, where people who are cheating can get caught so the honest businesses aren't at a disadvantage. The benefits are literally overwhelming. Every regulating agency that has looked at this has turned around and said, whoa, this is great.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, I see my time has expired, so thank you.
Thank you.
I thank the gentleman. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Florida, Mr. DeSantis, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Kosar, what is the reason why the Founding Fathers put the power of the purse with the Congress?
Well, they had had plenty of experience of abuse at the hands of the Crown, and I think there was just more philosophical agreement that if money was to be taken, it should only be taken by elected officials who are therefore accountable and can be taken out of office if they take more than they should.
So you have an executive, and they believe in separation of powers, so you have an executive branch. The executive branch is acting in a way that's contrary to either the interests or the rights of the public. Then those elected representatives in the legislature would be able to remedy that by simply refusing to provide funds going forward, correct?
The wealth and property of individuals will be better protected under a scheme by which only those who are able to be recalled through election or put out of office are able to extract it, yes.
And I think the problem with what we've pointed out here, and I commend the chairman for doing this, is when you have agencies that are effectively on autopilot with fees and whatnot, and we saw this with the dispute about illegal immigration when the president, even though he had said 20 times, you know, you can't do this, was then effectively issuing legal status unilaterally to certain people who were in the country illegally, the Congress said, wait a minute, you can't do that. But it turned out, we said, we're not going to fund it. Well, it turned out we didn't even need to take an affirmative act to fund it. They already had the fees through the USCIS, and it was just on and on they went without any need for congressional appropriation or authorization. And the problem with that is that that takes the default. The default should always be, if we just simply decide not to act, then the offending conduct stops. It should require Congress to take an affirmative act to appropriate funds for a given activity. And the way we've gone, we're insulating insulating the agencies from accountability from the Congress, but more importantly, from the American people, because they don't have a direct way to hold the agencies accountable. And I think that what frustrates me is that it's not like Congress had this power taken from us. Congress has given away the power and has offered to do this over the years. So let me ask you this. Well, this could be for anyone that wants to jump in. In terms of transparency, some agencies are not transparent at all. Some are very transparent. What agency would you say is the most transparent? Examples?
Mr. DeSantis, I would point to we were doing a lot of work on the overall spending and the transparency of expenditures, as is going to be required beginning this May under the Data Act. And I would point to the Small Business Administration, for instance. They have been able to take all of their spending information. They've been able to conform it to the new data structure, and they're now able to navigate seamlessly from their appropriation all the way down to each grant they issue and put all of that in a map in one click.
Anyone else? Go ahead.
Sure. Under the False Claims Act, those settlements are all made public. They're subject to court approval. Every dime given to the whistleblower is accounted for in a public document. It's been around for 30 years, and I don't know of any time that a member of Congress or even the public has said what the way the whistleblower was awarded was somehow bad, except for a whistleblower claiming they should have gotten more. But so there is transparency in the False Claims Act.
Let me ask about examples of Congress relieving agencies from the appropriation process, as I mentioned. When did this start? Ms. Krause, is that, I think you had mentioned it.
Sorry, I was looking back to my my colleague.
There have actually been examples.
We'll get you a chair.
Okay.
Sorry about that. There have been examples going back to, as was mentioned earlier, the customs officials early on in the Republic. There's also been a number of authorities just in this past 100 years where agencies are collecting fees, and Congress has either provided limitations on how they can use them or made them available without further appropriation.
And that process has become more conspicuous over the last 100 years. Is that fair to say?
Yes, that would be fair to say.
Okay. Well, look, I think that my friend from Alabama has a good bill. I think at some point, if we want to be anything more than a debating society, we're going to have to start reclawing some of this authority. You know what? It requires Congress to do more work. You actually have to legislate more. You got to make more decisions. Some people don't like going on the record as much, but that's just the reality. And it's easier to kind of say that just let everything run on autopilot. And I think some of the fees, it's not all bad the way it's done. Sometimes it is within law. But other times, it's simply government on autopilot, and that is not, I think, what the Constitution envisions, and I think it's up to us to start to claw this back. So I yield back.
I thank the gentleman. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Georgia, Mr. Heiss, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Krause, I just want to make sure, you stated that the GAO does not know how much is collected through the fees and fines and all that sort of thing. Is that correct?
There are data out there about individual ones. It has not been aggregated into a total. It's a very involved, complex process in terms of understanding the underlying specific legal authorities associated with those funds.
Well, in the first place, it seems like that would be information that not only you should have, but you would want to have. But secondly, this bill would correct that problem as well, if we're able to move forward. And Mr. Hollister, right along these same line, I want to just, for clarification, I want to make sure that you stated, you testified a while ago, that the Treasury can provide an accurate number for the fees, fines, and settlements. Is that correct?
Mr. Heiss, yes. My understanding is the Treasury can. The information that the Treasury receives from agencies is often in the form of summaries. So Treasury might give you amounts, but Treasury might not be able to walk that back all the way to the specific complexities of the legal authority under which each bunch was collected. Treasury, however, could give us, from the Central Accounting Reporting System, could give us aggregations. And my testimony was that Congress could direct Treasury to include that in the overall spending structure.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, I think it would be wise for us to request that number from the Treasury, just to have an idea of what we're dealing with here. Mr. Kosar, let me ask you, regarding the fines and fees, penalties, settlements, all this sort of stuff, how do you have any idea how much that has increased over recent years?
No, I do not.
who would have that information for us? Does anyone chart the increase of fees, fines, and settlements?
I would think OMB would have a number to use, and then presumably we could get some better data from Treasury.
I would also like for us to get that information if we can. And let's just for the sake of being in here, is it fair, do you think, to make the assumption that fees and penalties, fines have increased over the years? Is that a fair assumption?
I would say so, and I would say so probably as a proportion of the budget it has increased.
Right. I would say so as well, because we're now watching some agencies actually live off of those things. And so with the assumption that it is more than likely accurate that the fines, penalties, fees have increased, how does that, number one, enable these agencies to operate independently, but also how does that impact Congress's role?
Well, Mr. Heiser, it reminds me of Thomas Jefferson's letter to the Treasury Secretary complaining that the spending, even at that time in 1802, the federal government's operations had gone beyond the comprehension of Congress. The complexity at that point had already grown to the point where Congress couldn't comprehend it. And in this case, we see, because Congress has, over the last 200 years, delegated authority in very complex ways to agencies, we have a great deal of difficulty in getting that comprehension. I think we could start to regain it by consistently tracking that information and asking for that information to be put into the whole picture, integrated into the whole picture.
Well, I would absolutely agree, and it seems to me with the complexity that you mentioned, the more complex this whole scenario is, the more difficult it is to have oversight over it, and it gets out of hand rapidly, and it seems, and that, you know, this whole thing, and I just pick up on what Mr. DeSantis said, you know, this ultimately comes down to a constitutional issue, and fair enough, Congress over the decades has yielded some authority to these agencies, but we are on the verge of a genuine constitutional crisis now where those who are representatives are not having oversight and accountability, because those who are unelected in very powerful agencies are now able to operate independent from Congress and do multiple things. They're not even elected by the people. And all of this creates a potential enormous constitutional crisis. Would you agree with that, Mr. Kosar?
I would say it creates basic questions of legitimacy and concerns along that line, and it also leads, I think, to the perspective that, you know, where's the real power lie? Which branch? Eyes more and more turn to the executive branch. I mean, each time in an authorization, say, you allow an agency to collect fees for a particular purpose and spend them for a particular purpose, then, you know, okay, you're directing the congressional spending, but because it's put into an authorization statute, if that agency misuses the money or has too much of it, well, you're going to have to pass another law to get that back. And as we know, in this environment, passing legislation is very difficult. So the more of it that is kind of toggled in one direction, the more toggles you got to pull back if things don't work out right.
Well, I thank the panelists, and I thank my colleague from Alabama for this bill, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate your indulgence. I yield back.
The gentleman from Tennessee, Mr. Desjarlais, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Palmer, for bringing forth this legislation. Mr. Krause, if you would, your 2015 report illustrates the DOJ sidestepping Congress and providing deposits from federal fines and penalties to be immediately used to fund agency programs, correct?
Yes, that's our report.
Do you feel Mr. Palmer's legislation adequately addresses this issue?
The recommendations that we made in that report dealt a lot with the obligated balances, so the balances the agency holds that to manage the programs and the fees that come in. I'm not familiar, or I wouldn't know how that applies in the bill context.
Okay. So we already know the DOJ has taken advantage of using their fines to fund initiatives within their agencies. Do you know what percent of their budget that represents?
I believe in that report we talked about it being 15% of the budget in 2013.
Do you have a list of other government agencies that have also circumvented Congress and used fines, fees, and penalties without congressional authorization?
We have individual reports that we have in terms of those that have authority where they've been granted authority to use funds without further appropriations. We don't have a comprehensive list. We have examples of
that. Can you name a couple? Can you name a couple?
Yeah, sure. Some of those that include, I think we mentioned the National Park Service, the recreation fees that the National Park Service is allowed to use those for repair and maintenance. You also have the USDA agriculture quarantine fees. Those are examples of fees that they do not require any further appropriation beyond their current authority.
Is MSHA one?
MSHA being?
Mining.
Mining, health and safety.
I believe that is, yes.
Who determines the amount of the fine that's levied?
Sir, that depends on the statutory authority. In some instances, Congress will set the percentage or the amount of the fee. In other situations, Congress has, by statute, designated that the agency will follow a particular process for determining a fee, and so agencies use a variety of factors for that.
Okay. Mr. Jordan had mentioned the term shakedown in the process of these fines being levied and then sometimes negotiated. Who's authorized to negotiate, let's say, a fine is levied of $1 million and scares the heck out of businesses, and really there's never any intention of collecting $1 million, but that gets their attention. Who negotiates the actual fee or fine that's paid?
That also will depend on the statutory authority of the agency that is either imposing a fine or following the process to assess a fine. So in those situations, you know, depending on that statute, the agency will be able to, you know, make decisions about how much of a fine they need.
Do you think that's fair and effective to purposely mislead or levy a fine in instances to companies that obviously can't afford to pay that? I've seen it happen in nursing homes. I've seen it happen in mines. It happens in Department of Justice. That's the problem America has with overregulation in the federal government, is they feel like they're simply at their mercy. And I think the process of coming in and determining a fine, the EPA does this all the time. You have people that clear cut some timber and it happens to go beyond an acre, and they come in with a huge fine that they know they can't pay. And then when they negotiate it down to something still unreasonable, they are somehow expected to feel good about it. Do you think that's a fair process?
We actually haven't done the work to be able to determine if any specific case where that happens.
Well, can you tell me if any of these fines and fees are used within the agency? We know they're used to fund some of their own initiatives. Do the employees that go out and levy these fines, that start the shakedown, if you will, do they ever get bonused by the very fines that they levy?
We're not aware of those situations.
Can you say that there's not? Because this was a question I posed in a previous hearing, and we didn't get an answer, even though there was evidence that this was occurring. So you've never heard of that?
I'm not aware of any particular situation, sir.
Okay. So even though the DOJ has used this to fund their own initiatives, you don't have any evidence that the people who work for the DOJ benefit from these fines?
No, we don't have any particular cases in mind. We have received a request for a legal opinion from the Chairman Chaffetz of the committee to look at some supplemental agreements that are made with respect to the EPA, and so that's a project we're working on.
Okay, Megan, you can't tell me specifically who comes up with the amount of the fine and who's able to negotiate the actual settlement?
No, not in a general sense. Again, that would depend on the very specific statute and program and how that would be authorized.
Do you feel that's something that needs to be addressed? Or Ms. Krause?
I mean, certainly GAO is always, you know, we're definitely in favor of, you know, looking into, you know, particular programs and the authorities and how agencies use them.
Okay. I thank you for your time.
I thank the gentleman. Let me verify one thing. You said it's according to statute. A lot of these fines are not dictated by statute. I mean, in terms of what they are to fine. Is that correct?
Right. And that's why what we were saying is that depending on how the statute authorizes the agency to either impose a fine or assess a fine, then we would need to look at a specific situation to see what authority the agency had in that case.
So it just depends on that agency's statute?
Yes, that's correct, sir.
Do you not see that there would be a problem with lack of equality there?
You know, certainly that would be something to look into in terms of how an agency carries out those functions, carries out their statutory authorities. We just don't have any examples to be able to give you a specific example of one where there might be such.
I'm going to yield to the ranking member for just a very brief, and then we'll come to Mr. Grossman.
Two quick observations. I come from local government. It is the practice of local governments throughout the United States to levy fines, for example, on restaurants or food handling establishments when they find non-hygienic conditions, rat droppings, cockroaches, or unsanitary conditions in the kitchen. Maybe some people want to call that a shakedown. I can tell you where I live, my public thinks that's a measure of public safety and protection to make sure that food is sanitary and healthy and not disease prone.
The gentleman from Ohio, I can see where this is going. Go ahead.
Yeah, if it's going to the, if the fine is going to the local government, but what that's not what's happening at DOJ. There is a settlement, and then DOJ tells the party who supposedly done something wrong, you need to give the money to this nonprofit organization, which just so happens to have the political leanings of, well, may have political leanings. That's the problem, and they call it a donation. When you're forced to do it, it's not really a donation. I think it's a shakedown, the term I used before.
All right. We're going to go to the gentleman from Wisconsin, Mr. Grothman, for 5 minutes.
Okay. This is a question for any one of you. Next year's budget, obviously it would be nice if we had more detail here. It kind of surprises me the amount of funds that are going around that we probably don't even know the amount that's being spent. Can you make suggestions how, and I guess it would be Donald Trump's first budget, how in his submission to Congress we can begin to see more clearly how funds are collected and spent, what requirements we should put on that budget request?
Yes, sir. I'd recommend that Congress insist that the budget be expressed not just as a document, but also electronically, that it conform to the electronic structure that this committee has spent a great deal of time and effort mandating under the Data Act of 2014, so that the budget can be electronically compared to the records from the previous year.
Okay. Mr. Kosar, in your testimony, you mentioned that the government collected $516 billion from the public last year, right?
Correct.
To what degree do these, maybe outside the normal collections, is included in that amount?
I honestly don't know, because I find the categories that are used so confounding, and what we find in the President's budget is aggregate numbers in many cases. You'll have a line specifying a particular agency if it has a particularly large number, but then, you know, smaller amounts collected by agencies for other activities get rolled into one big ball. And so I would say it would be very nice if we had a better breakout and it was connected to legislative authority.
Do you think we should do something statutorily to mandate a more clearer delineation of where the funds are coming from?
I would favor that.
Okay, that's good.
Mr. Grothman, if I may, I would also add that there's the connection between the receipts and how they're ultimately spent is crucial. That's one thing that we're missing today. We don't have any kind of a system, even though Treasury has a system back behind there that does track what agencies are doing, we don't have a system that shows, that connects those receipts from non-appropriated sources to their ultimate expenditure. We know that that is technologically possible. We believe Congress should mandate that.
Well, I would hope it's technologically possible. In other words, when they have money coming in, even though some of that money is dedicated to a given purpose, that's not necessarily apparent from their budget?
It won't be apparent from the system, the way the system is structured today.
You know, it never ceases to amaze me how screwed up the federal government is. I tell everybody back home, I was a state legislator for 20 years. Washington is so much more screwed up than Madison, Wisconsin. You can't believe it. And one of them is how little information we get. We'll ask all of you again, are there agencies with funding streams outside the appropriation process, and I guess this kind of goes to you, which agencies in particular do you think could give us more transparent budgets?
Well, anecdotally, sir, we do know that some of the agencies that have independent research facilities, Defense Department in particular, but Energy Department certainly, there are often difficulties in comparing the budgets of those independent but federally funded research centers with wrapping them up and rolling them up to the overall budget of the agency.
Okay. Well, I'll see if we can do something. One other comment. One of the congressmen asked, I think maybe rhetorically, why they gave the power of the purse to Congress. And I guess I'll say the reason you want things in two different places is I think our forefathers were antithetical to the government growing at all. I mean, that's why you know, the senators were supposed to be appointed by the, you know, why were it so many checks and balances? I think that's obviously why. It should be very, very difficult for the government to spend any money or hire any new people. And the more things are spread out, the more difficult that'll be. But we'll yield my remaining minute to Congressman Jordan.
I appreciate it. I'm just struck because no one seems to be able to give us an amount. We had a colleague ask, has it been increasing, the fees, the fines, the penalties, the settlements? Has that number been going? We don't. The answer is, from our panel, we don't know. When asked the total amount in fees, fines, penalties, and settlements, the answer is, we don't know. Maybe the best way to get the information is to pass Mr. Palmer's legislation, right? Because then we would know. Because they got to all send it to the general fund, and we'll know what the amount, and with the appropriate amendments, Mr. Cohn, but we pass his bill, now we'll know, right? Because now it'll be, that's the whole, that makes the point why Mr. Palmer's legislation is so darn good. Because we'll know, and then we'll know year to year if that number's going up or down. This is why this is such a common sense thing and so constitutional. And as Mr. Hollister said, states are doing this. They're transparent. We know what, in Ohio, we know what's happening with fees and fines and penalties and settlements. It's just the federal government. We don't know. All the more reason to pass the legislation, then we'll know. I yield back.
I thank the gentleman. The gentleman's time from Wisconsin has expired. The gentleman from Alabama is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I want to thank all of my colleagues for attending this hearing and for the witnesses. And Mr. Kine, I want you to rest assured. I've read your testimony, and I actually called my chief of staff and told him that we needed to make sure that whistleblowers are compensated and that that's protected, so you can rest assured that we'll take care of that with a friendly amendment. I would like to ask Ms. Krause's question. Section 9, Article 1, Section 9, Clause 7 says, no money shall be drawn from the Treasury but in consequence of appropriations made by law. And a regular statement account of the receipts and expenditures of all public money shall be published from time to time. Are fees collected by the federal government public money? That's not a hard question.
No, I was going to turn it to my counsel.
Okay.
Yes, sir. The fees that are collected by agencies under the authority of Congress are considered to be appropriated funds.
No, the question is, are they public money?
Yes, sir.
Okay, they belong to the public, not to any individual, not to any agency, director, any. They belong to the public. Is that correct?
Right. Appropriate.
Okay, how about fines?
Synonymous to public money. Yes.
Fines. That would you answer an affirmative on fines? That's public money.
Yes, unless Congress.
How about settlements?
Unless Congress has specifically designated that they not be considered public or appropriated, they would be considered appropriate.
Okay, and I mean settlements, revenues from the sale of government assets that would be considered public money, wouldn't it?
Anytime Congress has designated sources of funding and said that agencies can use them, those are considered.
All right, thank you. I just want to make the point that H.R. 5499 is not a radical proposal. It is consistent with the Constitution. It's a constitutional proposal. And as my colleagues on both sides of the aisles have acknowledged, it's the duty of Congress to direct spending and not the agencies. And H.R. 5499 is not only consistent with that principle and that constitutional requirement, it advances it. It advances that responsibility. All my bill does is all H.R. 5499 says is that all fines, fees, settlements, all unappropriated revenues shall go to the Treasury identified with the agency where they originated, subject to being appropriated by Congress. It doesn't in any way diminish the fact that an agency might have access to those fees, what it does is it puts the responsibility back where it belongs. It restores oversight to Congress over the agencies, but more fundamentally, it restores accountability of Congress back to the people. And that's one of the main things that we've avoided over the years by delegating spending to agencies, whether it's through spending fees, fines, settlements. But we also are required by the Constitution to give a statement account of all receipts and expenditures of all public money. And with all due respect to my to the GAO and my colleagues and my friends there, and I really like what the GAO does. You can't answer that question. You've been asked repeatedly, and you can't give an answer to that. So I'm just, what H.R. 54 does is it would require Congress to review the unappropriated spending. It would give us the accurate number of how much we're actually collecting. And it may be that some agencies would be authorized or reauthorized on spending some of these fees. I don't dispute the use of some of these fees are necessary, but the use of the funds should also be proper. And if Congress is not appropriating and not exercising oversight, whether or not it's necessary, it's not proper. So I just think on too many occasions, agencies have circumvented the will of Congress, and Congress has shielded itself from being held accountable by the public by allowing this to continue. And I think H.R. 5499 would hold the agencies accountable, but more fundamentally, it would make Congress accountable to the people. And I just think that the fact that we failed to pass appropriations bills does not diminish the fact that Congress is not exercising the oversight and appropriation authority required by the Constitution. And that's what we're trying to reestablish here. Congress needs to be held accountable for the way the agencies operate. We need to exercise due diligence in our oversight. And if Congress can give the authority, it can take it away. But I believe H.R. 54 is a reasonable step toward restoring the constitutional oversight over agencies and Congress being held accountable by the people. And I appreciate, again, your indulgence, Mr. Chairman, and for the committee holding this hearing, and I appreciate the witness's testimony. I yield back.
I thank the gentleman. I thank the gentleman for his interest in this important topic. The chair is going to recognize himself for a few questions, and then we'll be prepared to close with closing statements. So, Mr. Hollister, let me come back to you, because I think in your testimony you indicated that the Department of Treasury actually has monthly statements where the total fines, fees, and settlements, I guess, as it relates to it. It may not be able to be tracked back to the genesis of where it started, but there is a total number. Is that correct?
That's correct, sir. There is a total number, and there are detailed tables. The trouble is it's a static document.
It's a what?
It's a static document.
Okay, a static document. And we know that your fine group is not static, right? One of the reasons why I get so excited about what you're doing is it adds a level of transparency where we'll be able to drill down and really start to look at it in a real meaningful way. Would you agree with that?
It ought to be interactive, sir.
So as we look at that, can you explain any reason why Treasury would not be able to give this committee, in response to a request that we've made, the total amount of fines and penalties that they've collected? What would be a reasonable rationale for them not being able to give this to this committee?
My best suggestion, sir, would be that the Treasury Department tried to minimize the scope of the request, as Legislative Affairs offices have been known to do. I've worked for the committee. I know how that works. And interpreted the request as a request for just the Treasury Department's own receipt of fines, fees, and settlements, which involves all sorts of
So what you're saying is we have a failure to communicate.
Yes, sir.
So if we have a failure to communicate, I think it would be prudent for us to make sure that as a staff, and they've already indicated that they're going to reach out to Treasury to get this number, because as my colleague, the gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Jordan, mentioned, it's starting to add up to real money here. We're talking about $600 billion. Is that correct? Based on the testimony from the White House budget and the $83 billion that we got in a report, the $600 billion, would you agree, how about this, Ms. Krause, would you agree that $600 billion is a large sum?
That is a large sum.
All right. And being that the President-elect Donald Trump wants to spend $1 trillion on infrastructure, That gets us half the way there with fees, fines, and settlement, doesn't it? You don't have to answer that. I'll just leave it at that. But so as we go here, I guess I use the humorous example in one area that's not so humorous to me. So let me come back to GAO. MSHA was mentioned earlier. And the reason why I drilled down on statute and what we can do with fines, fees, is because there is no guideline for MSHA in terms of the fines that they may give and the scope of that. It depends on the individual inspector on what he would give. And what I was troubled with is, and I didn't know this because I was just a new member of Congress going out to find out what was happening out there, and as I've recently found out that actually there was an empty Coke can on a desk at a mining group that they got a fine of well over $500 for having a Coke can sit on their work table. That happens in my office probably on a regular basis. So if MSHA had come in and fined me, I would have had this unbelievable fine. And then I went up
Wait a minute. Can we hit the address of your
office? Yeah. Well, yeah. I'm sure it's in Rayburn because you've got plenty of seniority. And so as we look at this, here's my concern. If we leave it up to a non-specified, arbitrary fine and fee schedule. It's one thing to say, okay, a fee covers the cost of this particular thing and this is where we collect it and it goes. That's one issue. But the other is the gentleman from Ohio pointed out on the settlement and the fines. That's a number that could go up or down based on no particular criteria. Would you agree with that? How many of the agencies have a defined, if you do X, it's going, the fine is Y?
I don't know the...
Does the EPA have that?
I don't know specifically.
I know the answer, but, I mean, do they have, if you violate a particular rule, that it always, the fine is always a set amount? In your experience, would you say that there is, that you could make an analysis that is linear in terms of their fee and fine structure?
I don't know that we could, sir.
Okay. So here's what I would ask of each one of you. We would ask each of you to report to this committee, if you can, three recommendations on what you would like to see. And if you would get back to this committee, and that might even include looking at the particular piece of legislation and problems that you may have with that legislation that may not fulfill the intended consequence. Mr. Kahn, I'm sure you can weigh in on that. There's a couple of others that Ranking Member and I have talked about, but three recommendations that we have. Here is the other question that I would ask for you is to prepare at least two questions that we can ask OMB, the IRS, and Department of Treasury when we have the follow-up hearing for them to be able to hopefully illuminate on some of these unanswered questions. Because you would think if any group would have a proper accounting of what's coming in and what's going out and where it's coming from, it would be OMB, Treasury, and the IRS. Would you all agree with that? Most of you nodding your head yes. And so let the record reflect that all witnesses answered in the affirmative. And so as we go with that, I just want to thank you. I'm going to recognize the gentleman from Virginia for his closing statement.
I thank the Chair, and it's an intriguing hearing, and I thank our colleague from Alabama for really bringing before us, I think, a very legitimate issue worthy of much further examination. I guess I'd make three points. One is, we talked about the Constitution and the role of Congress and the power of the purse. There has been no court ruling that I'm aware of in the history of the Republic that has challenged or questioned the constitutionality of Congress's right to delegate those authorities. So the fees and settlements and penalties in question so far apparently pass constitutional muster. So that's not the issue.
The issue is, has it gone too far? Is it de facto creating a situation where we're not doing our job? And if so, what's the remedy? What we have not examined here today, which you've heard me pursue, is, okay, what are the downsides? What are the consequences? If you cut off the TVA's ability to collect fees, what does it do to the mission of the TVA and the people it serves? And is that minor? Is it trivial? Is it easily correctable? Or is it something much more serious and significant that we have to contemplate, we have to take responsibility for? And finally, I think we're putting a lot of faith in our own appropriations process. The fact of the matter is, Congress is derelict in its duty, not so much by delegation of these fees and collections, but in our inability, frankly, to pass a normal appropriations process. And that's a bipartisan dereliction of duty. I worked in the Congress in the Reagan administration, and I can remember Ronald Reagan putting a big stack of papers, which was the omnibus funding bill that year, and talking about how shameful it was. That was over 30 years ago. And we do more of it, and that stack of paper would be even bigger today. To assume that we're going to take on more responsibility by approving every whistleblower payment or every settlement agreement or every fee to be charged, to me, is maybe something that constitutes a noble goal, but it is not something that's practical in this Congress or any future Congress, given our past record of performance in that regard. So I think there's a lot we have to think through before we act on this bill, but I do thank our colleague from Alabama for whetting our appetite and forcing us to deal with this subject, and I look forward to further investigation. And, Mr. Chairman, thank you for this hearing.
I thank the gentleman. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Ohio for his closing statement.
I thank the chairman. I just wanted to respond briefly to the ranking member, our good friend from Virginia. He talked about no court cases said Congress cannot delegate. That's accurate, but there was a court case in 76, United States versus McCollum, which said the Supreme Court has repeatedly affirmed, quote, the established rule is that the expenditure of public funds is proper only when authorized by Congress, not that public funds may be expended unless prohibited by Congress. So it's not a passive, it's an active role that Congress is supposed to play in this effort. Never forget what happens here. We have three categories: fees, fines and penalties, and settlements. No one can tell us what the total amount is. But we do know that the fees, according to the White House, just that alone is $534 billion, roughly half of what we spent in discretionary spending last year. We know fines and penalties is $83 billion over 5 years, but that excludes Treasury and the IRS. So we know that's a substantial number. And we know settlements, just the DOJ, is in the millions and millions of dollars, what they've required companies to pay, and not only pay to the DOJ, but to pay to some favorite nonprofits that the DOJ recommends that they give a, quote, donation to. So that's why what the chairman said just a few minutes ago is so important, that we get OMB in here, that we get Treasury in here, someone from the IRS who can answer our questions. That's plain and simple. And it, again, underscores, as I said earlier, why Mr. Palmer's legislation, maybe it needs some amendments, but I haven't seen many bills that come in front of Congress that don't need some changing, but why it's so important and so valuable. Maybe we also need the Inspector General, Mr. Chairman, the Inspector General from Justice Department to come in here and explain to us how this settlement game works when DOJ shakes down some companies. I'd like to know that, too. So this is an important subject. I want to commend the chairman for having this hearing, and I particularly want to commend the gentleman from Alabama for bringing this legislation. This is something we need to pursue. We need to make sure this bill gets done, gets passed, becomes law, because, like I said, if no one else will give us the number, when we pass the bill, we'll get the number, and that'll help the taxpayer. So with that, I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman. I want to mention the ranking member and I just had a conversation, and so we will be sending a bipartisan letter to request that information of Treasury, and so hopefully we'll get a little bit more specificity on that particular item. And I want to close by saying this. One, thank you all for your interest in transparency, for your interest in this particular subject. Mr. Khan, thank you for your support of whistleblowers. Specifically, it is a critical nature. Your graphs were very illuminating, and certainly we don't want to go backwards there. And I can tell you that I, for one, am committed to make sure we don't go backwards on that issue. I believe Mr. Palmer agrees with me on that particular item as well. For my friends at GAO, the follow-up hearing that we will be having, I would ask that you just be prepared, because you're going to be part of that, because the fourth leg of that chair needs to be GAO and what we have and have not been able to acquire. And so as we look at that, I just want to thank all of you for your interest. And if there is no further business before the subcommittees, they stand adjourned.